Greetings, everyone. I'll start off by introducing myself. I'm Kurapashe Tagarinda, and I'm a Senior Operations Research Fellow with the union and based in the AIDS and TB department in the Ministry of Health and Child Care in Zimbabwe. I'll give an example of an operational research study with emphasis on formulating a research question and the study methodology. So the study the title of the study that I conducted, and which was an outcome of the Union MSF operational research course, which was conducted in 2010 to 2011, was treatment outcomes of adult patients with new TB in relation to HIV status in Zimbabwe. I'll start off with the background of the problem. Sub-Saharan Africa is a high burden of TB and HIV, and Zimbabwe, which is situated in Southern Africa, is not spared either. In 2010, it was ranked 19 out of 22 amongst the high TB burden countries in the world. TB incidence over a period of 19 years between 1990 and 2009 almost trebled from 329 cases per 100,000 to 742 cases per 100,000. And this resurgence in TB is mostly attributed to the HIV/AIDS pandemic, which at an individual level lowers immunity and hence predisposes these patients to acquiring TB in comparison to those who are not HIV infected. HIV prevalence in Zimbabwe peaked to almost 1 in 3 people in the population in 2007 and sharply declined to 14.3, although which is high, in 2010, and has since plateaued since then. And this decline is mostly attributed to mortality and behavior change. Some more data on TB and HIV in 2009 shows us that new smear negative pulmonary TB cases and extra pulmonary TB cases had a lower treatment success of 69% in comparison to new smear positive pulmonary TB cases. Mind you, these new smear negative pulmonary TB cases and extra pulmonary TB cases are more likely to be HIV infected. Of all TB patients, 61% in 2009 knew the HIV status, of whom 78% were HIV infected. However, there is no data on uptake of cotrimoxazole preventive therapy and antiretroviral therapy. All this data is according to the WHO Global Report of 2010. Now, given this strong association, HIV and TB association, in accordance with WHO guidelines, TB patients in Zimbabwe should be screened for HIV, and of those identified as HIV positive, should be commenced on cotrimoxazole preventive therapy and initiated on antiretroviral therapy within 2 to 8 weeks after starting TB treatment, as these interventions are known to reduce case fatality. Now, it follows that those TB patients who are not HIV tested are obviously not able to access CPT and ART. And that led us to pose the question, do those TB patients who are not tested for HIV have treatment outcomes that are worse than those who are HIV tested? And with that, the aim of our study was therefore to compare TB treatment outcomes between new TB patients who are HIV tested and those who are not HIV tested in Zimbabwe. Our study objectives were then to determine in new TB patients the number and proportion who were HIV tested, stratified by age, sex, and type of TB, and also to determine final treatment outcomes, particularly treatment success, stratified by type of TB and by HIV status. So this slide outlines the different steps under the methods section, which I'll outline in the next few slides before we go into the results section. starting through from the study design right through to ethics approval. So what was our study design? It was a retrospective cohort study, since it involved, since our study involved abstraction of data from existing TB registers from the point at which patients started TB treatment until TB treatment outcomes were obtained. The study setting was Chitungiza District, which is a high density dormitory town, approximately 20 kilometers from Harare City, which is the capital city of Zimbabwe. And specifically, it was in all public health facilities. Mind you, all these facilities offer general health services, which are integrated with TB treatment services, of which TB diagnosis at that time was done at Chitungiza Central Hospital, and results of and the test that was used to determine whether someone had TB or not was direct smear microscopy. So results, sputum samples would then be sent to this lab, and then results would be then referred back to their respective clinics before patients were traced in the community and eventually started on TB treatment if they were found to have TB. So which patients were identified from the registers? In other words, what was our inclusion criteria? It was all new TB patients in the five public health facilities over a period of 1 year between 1 January and 31 December in 2009, who were adults, that is aged 18 years or older, and were new TB cases. New TB cases was defined as someone who had never been treated for TB or were previously on anti-TB treatment for a period of less than 1 month. Sample size. Whilst it is important to have a minimum desired sample size, in this case, it was not necessary for our study since it involved all patients who had newly acquired TB and were registered in the TB registers for the entire district over a 1 year period. In total, these patients amounted to 1,800. Now, the data variables that were collected included TB registration number, which was a unique identifier, since names were not collected for confidentiality purposes. Age and sex were the only demographic data that were obtained. We also obtained information of type of TB, HIV status, whether one had eventually initiated ART or not, or whether they had been started on CPT or not. Mind you, it's important that in operational research, especially of that of the nature which involves review of existing records, to always limit the number of variables that one collects. Whilst it is desirable to collect as many variables as possible, it is often the case that most data that one would be looking for is not available from the registers, especially in resource-limited settings where health workers tend to rely on paper-based systems for data entry. Also, the primary outcome that we also desired to obtain in our study was treatment success, in which case was defined as treatment success for, which was defined, sorry, as keyword for those with smear positive pulmonary TB or treatment completed for those with other types of TB, and adverse outcomes which were classified as death, default, failure or transfer out were also collected in this study. Data validation. This is another important aspect of a study. In this case, it was not possible since there was only one data source, which was the district TB register. However, one can always cross-check obvious errors against alternative sources of data, in which this case, which may have been clinic-based patient records, had they been available at the health facilities. So this slide outlines the variables that were collected on an A4 size data collection form, with the first row outlining the variables collected, right from TB registration date through to HIV tested status, yes or no. And the subsequent lines below outline data for each patient. Again, page 2 shows us a continuation of variables that were collected. After data was collected, all data collection forms were neatly filed in an ACBEC file, and afterwards, data was entered electronically into Epidata version 3.1. Double data entry, which is also another important aspect, was conducted to ensure that there were no transcription errors from transferring data from paper-based registers to the electronic database. And afterwards, data analysis was conducted in STATUS statistical software to perform descriptive analysis, bivariate and multivariate analysis for associations. Like all other studies, ethics approval is an important process, and in our case, ethical approval was obtained from the Local Ethics Advisory Board in Zimbabwe, which is the Medical Research Council of Zimbabwe, and also the Union Ethics Advisory Board. On to our results. Of the 1,800 patients who were registered over the 1 year period in 2009, 61% had an HIV test done, of whom 80% were HIV positive. 18% and 2% were HIV negative and HIV indeterminate, respectively. However, there were no data on cotrimoxazole or prophylaxis uptake amongst those patients who were found HIV positive. Also, we noted that only 9% of those who were HIV positive were documented to be on ART, of whom 81% had started ART after they had started TB treatment. Table 1 shows HIV testing and HIV serostatus in relation to TB type, sex, and age. Of note there is that a greater proportion of females compared to males had ever been HIV tested, although there were no differences in HIV positivity rates between the two groups. We also noted that HIV testing uptake was highest in the 25 to 44 year age group and the 45 to 54 year age group. And also, HIV positivity rates was highest in these two groups compared to those less than 25 and those greater than 55 years old. Table 2 shows TB treatment outcomes for all TB patients in relation to HIV serostatus. Overall, TB treatment success was 70%, with those not evaluated, that is those patients whom their TB treatment outcomes could not be established, with the highest amongst the adverse outcomes at 17%. When comparing those with an HIV test done compared to those with an HIV positive and documented to be on ART, we noted that there was a greater proportion of those who were HIV positive and on ART compared to those who did not have an HIV test done. That is 83% compared to 70%. Table 3 shows us adjusted risk, relative risks for association between HIV status and TB treatment outcomes. Of note there is that those who are HIV positive and documented to be on ART were 16% more likely to have a treatment success when compared to those who were not HIV tested, and this was statistically significant. We also noted that those who were 55 years and older were 23% less likely to have a treatment success compared to those who were less than 25 years, and this again was statistically significant. So what was our conclusion? In conclusion, we noted that there were no differences in treatment outcomes between those who were HIV tested and those who were not HIV tested. That having been our main research question that needed to be answered. Other findings included low HIV testing uptake, especially amongst males, that there were less than 10% of those who were HIV infected we started on ART, and that there were better treatment outcomes in those who were HIV infected and started on ART when compared to those who were not HIV tested. We also noted that old age, that is 55 years and above, was associated with lower testing uptake and worse treatment outcomes, and perhaps could reflect other comorbidities that these patients could have had, but were not identified. So what are our program implications? Or what were our program implications then? It was that there was a need to increase HIV testing uptake and a need to improve registration of TB patients to ensure that the proportion of patients with TB treatment outcomes not evaluated be lessened, and also to ensure that patients were identified as HIV infected were started on ART so as to improve their treatment outcomes and lower case fatality. That brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you.